Best thing in the movie.
Oh, that dog is great. Huh? Was that Beagle?
Yeah.
It looked like
Yeah,
a
it looks like a
beagle.
beagle.
Oh, this is
That
cute.
scene where he pretends that the car ran over the dog lays perfectly still, and then he sticks his tongue out and stays
Yeah.
like that for the whole shot.
I swear he winks at somebody at some
Yes.
Yes, he
And then it cuts to a
does.
close-up and he looks up to
They
see if there anybody's looking.
gave the dog sedatives.
I'm sure they did.
So
listen.
this does not qualify for no animals were harmed in the making of this movie, much like Amores Perros, because they gave the dog sedatives.
What well, Mike and
Do you
that
know
cool
for a fact they gave the
our
dog
actually
sedatives?
cool
Yes.
our cool hand
It's
Luke
on the
actually.
Wikipedia.
All right.
Oh my goodness.
Most of the time he's doing some good acting though.
Hey, maybe the dog likes
It took him
sedatives.
like it took him like 3 or 4 weeks to train the dog to do the go get the wrong
Screwdriver.
screwdriver and then go get the right screwdriver.
Damn, man. I mean, that is impressive. Sedatives
Phillips.
or not.
Yeah.
Well, they didn't give him sedatives for that scene.
No, of course not. I'm just saying,
No,
in
they
general,
gave
the dog's performance was the thing I enjoyed most about this
Now,
film.
Chris and I are focused on the very first scene, the very first segment
Give
of
him
the film,
amphetamines
which
for
is a Zemeckis signature. He tells you what's going to happen the entire film in the first scene. He did it in Back to the Future, right?
Back to the Future's got an exceptionally good opening
Yeah,
shot.
so does this. This tells you everything you need to know about the film right up there. Maybe a couple scenes afterwards where you kind of establish what his political ambitions are.
Yeah, I would say that this one has less information in it, but it does kind of set the tone, that's for sure.
Yeah, the tone's fully set by the time you're up and running. That's great. And Kurt Russell was. He was so much fun when he was this old. He was just loose and having a good time. It was great to watch him kind
This
of.
isn't long after the computer wore tennis shoes, is it?
Not that long, no.
Which is like, yeah, 1968 or
Yeah,
something. Year,
it's
2 years
like
before
ten
the
years,
thing.
12 years after that. This is
Okay, so that's a good
York.
10
Yeah,
years at
you know what
least.
he's about to do right after this
The
is
Thing.
escape. No, Escape from New York.
Yeah, that's
Oh,
right.
2 years
Two years later. Yeah,
he's about to do
perfect for
Escape
that when
from New
he's in
York, and
this.
he's going to do The Thing, and then he's just, it's on the
Right.
stratosphere.
Yeah.
And I guess they hadn't seen him in this movie when they cast it, because why the fuck would you cast this guy in something like Snake Plissken?
I
Right.
know.
But it
It's weird,
worked.
huh? You would think
Well,
that the Snake, the
John
universe.
Carpenter cast him because of Elvis.
Yeah.
Yeah, that too. But that was the TV movie too, so it's like it's
Oh,
kind of
right,
strange.
right, right,
Yeah.
right.
But
Listen, I don't know that this is a his, I don't before the other youngster shows up to shit all over this. I don't know that I could sit there and get in my soapbox and say this is a good movie. I,
no.
however, love the shit out of it
What do you
because
mean? I'm
all those
sorry.
movies. Well,
It's a fun
this is going to
movie.
be a generational
No,
thing.
it's
I totally
not.
get it. This is one of a dozen or more movies that came out in the wake of Animal House. I probably own most of them. And, it's that sort of, you couldn't make it now. It's extremely problematic, blah, blah. Yes, all of those things, but I can quote enormous chunks of it. And even looking at it somewhat detached, knowing we were going to have a conversation about it, like, no, I mean, it's weirdly sloppy in parts, but it's got this goofy charm that I think works in its favor. Everybody in it seems to be having a pretty good time. I mean, listen, out of nowhere toward the end, we get these two fucking guys, which is great.
Yeah, Lenny and
Lenny
Squiggy.
and
The
Squeegee.
best characters, the
Lenny
best
and Squiggy
characters in the movie by far.
by
After
far,
the
yeah.
dog.
If I could create and design and install a pacemaker in this man's chest, I can make this happen
Like
for
when he's like, stop touching it. Like,
Yeah.
that's the thing. He kept
It's still weeping.
the comedy in this thing. They will refer to something, then they'll hit it three times or
Yeah.
four times afterwards.
Well, how
You
do you
know
change
what's
the
going on.
batteries? It's rechargeable.
Yeah.
Just to wrap.
1979, really? You made a rechargeable pacemaker? I
Yeah.
don't know.
I'll just say, like, Scott, you picked Where's Papa 6 weeks ago,
Yeah,
which was,
right.
I did think of that.
Well, it's just, I give Scott credit for, I've held off.
Continuing to
I think
pick bad comedies.
Yes.
Comedy might be the most subjective thing. It's either funny or it isn't. And that's,
And this isn't.
well,
Dude,
sure. Like,
the thing
that's like your
about this
opinion.
film, in terms of
I get it.
comedy, it is a total reflection of its time. This is
For sure.
Carter
Has it
era
aged
comedy.
well?
This is don't believe in anything. Nothing is good. Nothing is wholesome. Nothing is honest comedy.
Well, they knew that Reagan was coming.
Yeah, they knew
I
it was
really
coming.
wish. I really wish
Reagan was
they
already
made
there.
a joke about the daughter driving a Toyota. They just let
They kind
that
of referred to it a
slide,
little bit. It
right? And they just
was
let it
visually
slide.
referred to.
I was so like, oh, these guys are going to make a joke about her having a Japanese car among yeah. all of these, you know,
American
mostly
steel.
American, one German car mm. in the whole thing. And I was just like waiting
which
for that.
They
it was
blow
like,
up.
Yes, which yeah. they do blow up.
And high.
The thing I have to say about this movie is this is what a friend of mine who's a stand-up comic would call joke-shaped objects. Like, this movie is just full of these things that are designed in the way a joke would normally be designed, but it doesn't have any of the impact that you would want out of comedy. Like, there's it.
You didn't laugh.
No, ever.
Wow. Like, I off of this film.
I'm not.
I was so annoyed by that while I was watching it. It was like, could you please just follow through on one of these things in a way that's funny? And I just didn't find any of it to be funny. And it just, it goes on and on and on. That last scene of them driving all the cars through the desert is 25 minutes long.
And was the precursor to the Blues Brothers.
No. Chris says
same
no.
Year. Brothers,
I think these were like that.
Actually, you got used cars, along. Blues Brothers, and Airplane all the same year.
Yes.
Yeah. This is not like Airplane at all. This isn't one of
no.
No, because Airplane's funny. Good.
No, hold on.
I'd argue it's got more in common with 1941.
This has got more in common
which is the problem.
The style of the comedy in this film is a lot like Slapshot. From 76.
I remember a critic calling this kind of movie holy shit comedy.
Yeah, if you like.
But it's like, you know, the Blues Brothers, let's crash a car through a shopping mall. Holy shit.
But this is that weird nihilist 70s thing where you just kind of
Blues
like.
Brothers, man.
Yeah, where you just kind of like don't believe in anything. And that's it's the whole story is a content of a treatise on honesty. Because.
Yes.
The honesty is not held in any regard at all by the main characters in the film. Then this woman comes along who is depending on the honesty of other people, and she gets completely screwed by it. And then
and then corrupted by it.
Then corrupted
yeah.
by
at
it.
At the very
yeah.
end
yeah,
of
it's
it.
It's such a foul ending.
The final message of this film is like, no, honesty still doesn't matter.
You learned how to lie.
You learned how to lie, exactly. Oh, here's Jared. Hold on.
If Russo had gotten elected, he would be one of the guys like trying to push the independent state assemblies shit. Like,
oh yeah,
he'd be that guy.
This
now.
Is Arizona, oh, after sure. all.
No, like, there's that scene in the car where he's like, "So what are my positions?"
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
He's got a briefcase full of money.
Yeah. He would be the Trumpiest
if
guy.
If he was the modern politician, yeah. you know? He'd be like the guy. It'd be handing him a position list from the MAGA guys. Like, just
yeah.
Just
hey, Jared.
Hey, Jared.
Sorry, I'm late.
Dad hates it. I think Jim liked it. Chris remembers it fondly from his childhood. I don't hate it as much as Dad, but I thought it was pretty terrible.
I laughed a lot still, even though I understand why most people might not find this funny.
I think it's an important cultural document of its time.
There's a word that came to mind while watching this movie, and that is zany.
Yeah,
yeah. It's like,
and
it's
I
like
fucking hate zany like so much.
It's like a morning zoo radio show.
This movie yeah. is awful, and I didn't laugh once except when his dead body was driving in the car heading for the. I kind of laughed when they cut to him.
He's got the quarters on his eyes.
I know. Jesus.
Well, when they cut to him actually moving in the car, I was like, oh, that kind of is funny. I never liked this is just one step away from a National Lampoon movie.
It actually has a similar,
which would be better because it was better written.
And I think that if you're ready for Kentucky Fried Movie or Naked Gun or Top Secret, you're like,
okay, hold on, stop right there.
I'm ready for this. I'm in for this, even though it's stupid. I'm in for it.
John Milius isn't that good of a writer.
Well, here they're not. They're like, we've got one foot in that camp and one foot in like regular comedy. Lack of a better term, and it doesn't work.
Yeah, but Kentucky Fried Movie was an anthology comedy. It actually is zany by the way you mean zany, and that nothing is serious and nothing is realistic. This film
tries to be a little bit realistic.
Stays within its own universe of logic.
Yeah. Right. There is no logic to
anything
Kentucky Fried Movie.
Ordinary.
Kentucky Fried Movie is the
it's just a bunch of blackout sketches.
Yeah, it is. And so you can be as zany as you want in terms of like
but this. I almost kind of laughed when that guy was shooting the prices. That was because it's just the way he's all another fucking two fucking high. Like, that was kind of funny, but yeah,
$24,000
right
before that. I was pretty much in agreement.
When you grow up with, like, Back to the Future is, you know, obviously a favorite of, you know,
well, you
most...
see where the roots of that film are.
Well, yeah, like when you're a kid and you see Back to the Future, I thought like some really sophisticated adult made that, and I forgot that Robert Zemeckis at one time was a young guy, and this is what he did, and it's awful.
He's still not a
this is him honing himself later. For that something like Back to the Future that he actually sit down and really seriously think about what he's going to do. This is just kind of throwing spaghetti against the wall in a lot of ways, but
yeah,
there's another movie we'll get to the second one. There's another word that I want to describe both these movies, and that is silly. But
okay,
we'll
that's
get to that.
Oh, they're definitely silly.
I think you go too far, sir. But okay.
No,
I just want to say
I don't think you go far enough. Honestly,
I was kind of in Tad Stupid and Jared's camp. I was kind of siding with Tad and Jared.
You're a party pooper.
And giving it a zero, but I notched it up a couple. I gave it a one or a two.
Because of the dog.
Well, the dog gets you 1 point. Maybe the boobs get you another point.
The boobs were good.
Just watch pornography. Pornography everywhere.
But here's the thing.
Let me finish.
Go ahead.
I'll tell you where I kind of warmed up to this movie a little bit was the bar scene where the football game's on the TV.
Oh, yeah.
Jeff starts pouring all the salt shakers out and breaks the mirror, and he tries to crawl under that stepladder that's on the floor behind the bar for some reason.
I think his ass kicked by the bartender.
I thought that was pretty damn funny. It's like it set up the premise.
That's like 80% of a good bit. A better writer could have found something in there to pull out that would have been really good.
Like a clapper.
But this was a comedy of its era, and so all the characters had gimmicks. Jeff was superstitious.
He's superstitious. He can't drive a red car.
This guy's black. That's his gimmick.
No, he's not. He's narcoleptic.
He falls asleep everywhere.
With a welding torch.
Yeah.
Twice.
Yeah.
And Kurt Russell's character is just as cynical as fuck, and that one's naive. He's scummy. It's like everyone's kind of doing the arch character.
I will say.
Also, let me tell you how much I loved the judge character. That's what's his name?
Al Lewis.
Grandpa Munster.
I voted for Al Lewis for governor of New York.
Oh, good for you.
Al Lewis ran for governor of New York.
He knew what party candidate he was three times,
and I voted for him once because it was the only time I was old enough. But God damn it, he should have been governor of New York.
That would have been great.
Yeah.
The opening shot of this movie is excellent, though. I will say that.
Technically superior.
It's absolutely gorgeous.
There's a lot of really good technical stuff in
this. Yeah, it's a technical thing where it's literally a wide shot and goes to the odometer close up without a cut, and it's really, really masterfully done.
Yeah, they keep it in focus.
I know.
Yeah. So I was like, that's really cool. And then they abandoned all of that coolness immediately.
Zemeckis is a really good technical filmmaker.
They had to kind of like,
and that'll come up again in the second film.
They had to distribute their eggs in different baskets. So the big chase at the end with 1,000 cars, that was all the money there. And the opening scene was all the money there. So they had to
actually good stunt work on the car chasing scene.
It was. It was really.
I want to say something about that though,
please,
which is when they're like speed up to 75 and it's very obvious that the two of them are in the back of the truck going about 22 miles.
You know what? You're right, because that's actually a common thing in movies where people like flying along really fast. Right. Actually, you know, they're going 35 or 40 miles.
Right. You wouldn't his face would be rippling.
I know. Right. 40 miles an hour, you can't get out of the car because your wig will come off. Right.
I do want to say that long sequence at the end where they're driving the cars through the desert and jumping from one car to another and all that stuff. I mean, if you change the score, which was terrible in that 80s kind of way, I mean, it was kind of like Mad Max, you know, with less death.
Same year.
This movie is
year,
almost...
Was it 1 year after Mad Max? 79?
Yeah, I was impressed with the stunt work a lot.
If you change the music in this movie, it becomes a horror movie about the awful brother killing people.
I'm disappearing. I'm a ghost.
Hi, Sheila. Ghost Sheila.
Oh, but she I do give it... I do give it another
dog. We don't know
this guy.
I do give it another point for the boobs as well. Like, it's the kind of movie, and no. I knew these guys were the kind of filmmakers where the minute I saw that woman in the green dress, I'm like, that's coming off at some point. I'm like counting the seconds.
She was playmate of the movie.
Like,
she was playmate. I thought this part of the film would appeal to you, Jared. That's the thing.
Oh yeah, that was like my favorite part. I watched it twice. I was like, let me rewind that and watch it one more time.
You're the little kid going, look. Look, bare tit.
I was the kid by the TV. I'm all, look, the movie's good now. The movie's good now.
Actually, the reactions during that part where everyone is topless.
I like the dad. He's like, get out of the way.
Various neighborhoods, that was the absolute best. Like, this guy's in bed with his girlfriend. He kind of looks over her, looks
at her. The best visual gag in this movie comes after that, though, where they leave the lot in the station wagon, and it hits the bump, and the two kids go out of the back into the
The football player
quickly in the mud. The best visual gag. And then they have to jump up and run
right in the mud.
The weird thing is, it's like back when I was a kid back then, I knew a lot of like 8 or 9 kid families, you know, growing up. And so that didn't surprise me at all.
Well, he's Irish because you know that, because when he comes over and starts talking to him, Russo changes his name to like Russo O'Flaherty or something like
that.
Yeah,
like, it's very interesting. Yeah, it's good stuff.
We haven't heard much from Jim yet.
He liked it.
Had you seen this, Jim?
I'd never seen it. I'd been holding off.
Saving it
to savor it. I found myself thinking of, although it's later, like 10 years later, Repo Man. Just had this kind of low.
Weird. It's only a couple years off.
Production value.
Repo Man.
And very focused on cars.
But Repo Man comes from a different kind of soul. Yeah. It's got like this anarchist punk.
Right. Repo Man is also quality. Dark. It's a really dark movie.
And it's like, Repo Man is a clever comedy, whereas this is a broad comedy, right? Like,
I mean, it did kind of remind me of.
Yeah, it's a comedy with broads. You're right.
This is the one where actually they got
broad in both sense of the words.
Reminded you of what, Jim?
Forgot.
We could tell this is kind of a story, but it's Zemeckis and Gale wrote and dropped over the studio. And they're like, you know what? Why not? You're fine.
This will make money. Fuck it.
Yeah, exactly. Go shoot in Phoenix because it's cheaper back then. It was a tax shelter back then.
Right. It was the Atlanta of its time.
But they had to buy a lot of old used cars because they didn't have CGI back then.
Like, there weren't a lot of used cars back in the late 70s.
especially floating around.
That was the easy part, man.
Especially floating around outside of Phoenix.
Exactly. Right? Exactly.
So, and this is a weird year because this technically came out in 80, but you know, so everything looks 70s though, because technically this was filmed in the
70s.
You probably got this memory. So this movie was not supposed to come out when it did. It came out like on our birthday, basically 1980.
Yes.
But that was because the studio pulled it forward by a number of months and then didn't have enough time to market it.
Right. So Nobody saw the marketing. So this movie made no money.
As it came out, made no money.
Yeah. In fact, I only saw this on cable myself. I only saw it on HBO.
It probably made more money off of HBO than it did off of box office.
Oh, without question.
Nobody saw this.
But it got his ball rolling. That's one thing. That led to some good stuff later on.
Yeah.
I can't believe that after 1941, they were like, go ahead and make another movie.
That's because in a just society,
that would be the end of your career.
That's because Spielberg was the Saint Sebastian. He took all the arrows on that one.
That's true.
Yeah. So there it is. My God, are we done?
Was Zemeckis involved with 1941?
No. Milius and Spielberg were.
Definitely John Milius movie.
Oh, so we're saying you can't believe John Milius got to write another movie after 1941?
This is the type of comedy that assumes that blowing cars up is going to
is funny.
Hilarity.
Yeah.
I
have two words for you, Red Dawn.
1941.
I love Red Dawn.
1941 is an American comedy film directed by Steven Spielberg and written by Robert Zemeckis.
Bob Gale and Bob Gale.
My stepdad did the movie poster, and I got
Spielberg,
to go.
Spielberg produced this film. That's the thing, right?
Yep.
And I may be
in the minority, but I fucking hate Blues Brothers, dude. I hate that movie.
Yeah, I think you are actually.
No, it's actually more uneven. It's actually Blues Brothers is more uneven than this because it is.
But the peaks are much higher.
Yeah, the peaks are higher, but this is actually I think Blues Brothers is more guilty of being zany, as Jared said, than this. Because that film is zany.
No, because again, it goes to that absurdist.
The Nazis go to that absurdist space. Going to the ground, you realize.
Also, I think that John Belushi is super overrated.
It goes to that absurdist space that this movie refuses to go to. This movie gets so close to absurdism at certain points and just misses. And it's like.
He's better than Jim Belushi.
No, that's it. You're making a very good point, Tad, because this is like comedy sometimes can depart from reality and sometimes it can't.
Right.
This film constrains itself to reality.
Also, how the fuck would she have forgiven him?
She wouldn't.
Just because he saved the used car lot? No, you still buried my dad in a pit out back.
There's no fucking way she would have forgiven him.
The morals are moment to moment.
No way.
The morals are situational.
Why would you listen to him in the court?
That's exactly right, Jim. The morals are situational. That's exactly right.
Ebert said something really clever about this. He said, better comedies make profound jokes out of mundane scenarios, and this movie makes really lame jokes out of these big, huge scenarios.
Big issues.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, this is about the moral corruption.
Good comedy is taking serious things not seriously, and bad comedy is taking non-serious things extremely seriously. Yeah. Like
This was taking the moral decay of the late 70s and kind of running with it.
Well, he's just saying that like all these situations are so big and they get a tiny joke out of it where if you're a better writer, you can have a small moment and get a really, really big joke out of it.
Wow. I thought they threw no spaghetti.
Also, was I the only person who thought all the cars were overpriced?
No, this guy obviously thinks all the cars are overpriced.
Shoot him. We're fucking shooting that one.
All right. We're going to cards at this point. That's it. We're done.
All right. I'm going to give it a couple of.
Purely nostalgic.
If this is down, I'm going to give it like a couple of points.
I'm with Jared on that.
That's great.
It's not a vertical down. It's just
we're at our best, and we actually disagree on all this shit. So that's great. So, all right, well done.